We can get started. Thank you all so much for coming out to this latest in our colloquium series. I want to welcome Ken Anderson to our department and to our campus and introduce his talk. But before we do that, I want to say one other thing. This talk is part of a series of colloquia that we offer under an Engaged in Applied Anthropology series. And that that series, like a couple of other really exciting programs in our department, including a summer research opportunity for our undergraduate majors and an internship internship opportunities for undergraduate majors, is supported by an alumni donor of our department, Mr. Paul Lehman. And usually about once a year, we have the pleasure of having Paul join us around our colloquium table to be part of the conversation. And I'm really happy that this is the day that Paul is here. So allow me to introduce Paul Lehman and thank him publicly for all of his support. And now to give you an indication of the fantastic things that Paul's support makes possible, I'm really thrilled to welcome Ken Anderson to our department. Ken is an anthropologist trained at Brown University. He is a principal engineer of the Intel Experiences Group and is basically an anthropologist engaged in bringing a lot of ethnographic insight and ethnographic skills to industry, thinking about and he's also very well positioned to help us think about what it is that we as anthropologists bring outside and beyond beyond the world of academia. Ken works at Intel. He's also been at Apple. He is a 15-year employee now of Intel, which is very stable and has a remarkable. I hesitate to even summarize the kind of research he's done because we were talking at lunch and it's clear that there's a series of
talk,
fantastic.
Worry.
Okay, I don't want to steal his.
Yeah, don't steal my talk.
I don't want to steal his talk. Well, fantastic. I'm really pleased that you're joining us and giving us this this presentation. Please welcome me in.
Could I say just a couple
absolutely.
Of words?
Oh, of course.
Yeah. Be okay with you?
I'm thrilled.
You got
if you could do 45 minutes worth.
I just want to thank everybody here and. I've enjoyed supporting this program. Andy and I have been, Andy has stimulated a lot of this, and I think we're on the right path here. I'm a 69 graduate of this department in anthropology. I've had a long career in business, making electronic components. And I part of the industry. So I want to welcome you to the Silicon Prairie. Much better here than Santa Clara. Just one little factoid. You may or may not know this, but Intel recruits the largest number of recruits out of the EE school, electrical engineering school, by far, is his company. So in that context, Ken, come here. You're stealing my line there. You come here to the Silicon Prairie and recruit double E's. Maybe you could sneak a few anthropologists into the mix. So I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say. I feel there's a real connection between the type of company he works for and using anthropological techniques to come together and do something interesting. And thanks.
I'll tell you right away that there are no current jobs at Intel. But we were meeting earlier this afternoon with some graduates and undergraduates and talking about careers and job titles and that. A friend of mine just posted this. It says research strategist. That's you guys. It's not the kind of job that says anthropologist on there, but it is the kind of job for anthropologists. So when you think about this, I mean, that's part of the trick. This is my only plug. And then I'll do one more plug, because I helped start an organization called epicpeople.org, which is largely about people who do ethnography, broadly defined, well outside the realm of anthropology, to some chagrin. But nonetheless, and it's all about promoting ethnographic techniques and methods in businesses. And all the content is here for free for merely registering. But if you're interested in, and I have job postings, as you can see. So if you have interest in that area, you should check out ethnicpeople.org. It's relatively new. So I'm going to talk about my work, but I'm not going to do a talk about work. I'm going to talk about my work. And as a frame for that, I want you to think about a book that was written by Dal McKenzie a few years ago, over a decade ago now, called An Engine, Not a Camera. And what I want you to consider is both, is my work an engine or a camera, and do you want to be an engine or a camera? Before I even start that, I do have a couple of caveats. One is, my advisor attended this university, so I'm triply pleased that you guys invited me here. It's my first anthropology talk this decade. I do a lot of talks at computer science, information schools, business schools, but not so much with anthropologists. And so I appreciate that. He graduated, Paul, in 1969 with a PhD. I think he was a Casa Grande student, but I heard a lot of stories of Julian Stewart's farm. So this is, for me, this is a rare thing, and I'm very pleased that you invited me. The other thing is that I want you not to be afraid of me too much, even though I see you all sat in the back rows thinking this is some wild, crazy person from industry. For those of you who do not know, this is Ed Lebeau, who's the director of the AAA. And I have a 100% validation from Ed that I won't say anything that he'll regret later on. I have a long connection with anthropology and anthropologists, and I've worked a long time with them. It's just not recently. The other thing is, I'm not here to sell you on becoming a business anthropologist. It's not my attempt to convert you. And I hope you do whatever you want to do. I'm hoping that this provides an insight into some of the kind of work that anthropologists who are not in academia are doing. But I'm not here to pressure you. I'm not going to defend my job for anyone. So it's just what I do, and you kind of have to live with that. And I also am not here to say that anthropology cures all. There was a recent thing yesterday that came through at the People about a conference on the world needs anthropologists, and I told the group this afternoon, I'll tell you, the world really doesn't want anthropologists, and we are hugely important to it. So you figure that problem out. But it is something that people in industry face all the time. The kinds of insights we have are crucial to doing things right, but there's a huge pressure not to do things the way we want them to go. So anyway, on the lighter side of the world, so Donald McKenzie wrote this book, An Engine, Not a Camera, and I'm pretty sure nobody here probably read it, maybe you. But I basically, and Andy, I know Andy did. So I basically posited that economists are about their formulas and constructs aren't just capturing what the market is, but are actually generating new kinds of activity in the market itself. And the classic example of this has to do with
Black-Scholes.
Yep.
The Black-Scholes Merton, the options pricing.
The option pricing, and in 1974 there were virtually no options being priced. And in 2004, when he was collecting data from the book, it was $237 trillion worth. And then you know what happened in the years later. But the point is that, you know, he was arguing that his field was largely about being an engine for the market, not just capturing it. This is a scene, it's kind of blurry, this is a film capture from a movie called Kitchen Stories. It's about, get this mixed up sometimes, it's either about Swedish anthropologists studying Norwegians, or Norwegian anthropologists studying Swedes. And I honestly have forgotten at this point. But what captured this for me, it was somewhat funny, but it was also a documentary. So it wasn't funny, was that the when I was in graduate school, this is kind of what we were taught to be. We were taught to be sort of observers of the social and cultural, and then we would write that up and describe it in some rich detail. But what I find sort of interesting is that I feel like I've moved a little more towards the I did pick a Swedish car because I drive one, and that was Swedes before. So I have a theme here. Just so you know, this is the symbols here. It's a very multi-directional talk. But part of what I think that has kind of challenged me as a person is where do I fall on that line between being part of an engine for the corporation and for the tech field in general, or being a describer of that and more removed. So I'm going to go through some of my stories, and then we'll let you decide where I fall at the end, and then let you think about where you might want to be. So context is still important, believe it or not. We haven't eliminated it yet. My company does one thing, and one thing only: we make chips. We don't make computers, we don't make phones, we don't make cameras, we don't make TVs, we don't make cars, we make chips. Now all those things happen to go inside of chips, which chips go inside those things, which is important. But to make one of these, it takes now 4 years. It used to take 6 when I started, but it takes 4. So my job is not to make these, but decisions have to be made about what these chips need to be able to do. You can only put so much on them. They actually, as you know, at 7 microns, or nanometers, as they're at 7 nanometers, you can only do so much. And so decisions, engineering decisions have to be made. Part of my job is to help engineers decide what kinds of capabilities will people need in 4 years. And so I was just helping the team lock down on the 2020 production last fall. Now it's set. This is very, very, very different than the software world or the web interface world, where Google and Facebook are tweaking their algorithms literally on a daily basis. The kind of feedback here, the kind of information, is different than those kinds of companies need. So my position is not particularly universal in that sense, but it is in the sense of the kinds of work that we do is often the kind that you find at Google and Facebook as well. So we have two models of how we help these engineers decide. It's not findings, or insights. Those don't work. Those are like one-offs to the way they think and intel. But it's through two tools. One of them is personas, where we take our particular way of approaching them, there's many ways of doing them, is we take a person from one of our studies and develop a complete picture around them as it applies to the decisions that need to be made. So that's, you can think of them as partial fiction if you like. And because in part they are a little bit not exactly true biographies, they are definitely scaled down. And these tend to circulate with engineers as I am designing for the Andy persona, or I'm just designing for the Jacinta persona. It depends on, you know, where they have arguments. Andy would want this, Jacinta would want that. Who do we think are really more important in our decision? So we have these kinds of tools that do generalization of a number of factors inside of them. One of them might be more security interested, one of them might be more socially interested, one of them might be more media. It depends on what the kinds of decisions that we need to make. The other thing that we do is we eliminate context by inventing context. So we have usage models, which we also give to the engineers to help them decide what kind of use do you imagine this to be. I imagine video should be handheld and portable wherever I go. That is a usage model. Or the instantiation might be on a bus, it might be in a car, it might be on a plane, it doesn't really matter. We have to create sort of models of kinds of behavior. Those are two kinds of things that we do that are not really findings, but aggregates of kinds of findings or insights we have. So that's job one, is to feed kinds of broad information to those people. They're not trends, by the way. I don't do trends. So, but they're around values. My other day job, which takes up more of my time, since we only recycle, you know, every 4 years, and it's a little lag on that one. My primary job is developing new business opportunities at Intel. I've had different jobs, but mostly they've all revolved around something in the future. And this is a current instantiation. In particular, I do the phase before you actually build anything whatsoever at all. So it makes it kind of fun. The building stuff and how it actually works, there's a different set of people who often there's anthropologists in that group as well, but it's a different set of people, a different set of skills. And our particular approach in my group is to look at something that's in flux. So it's kind of the antithesis of a lot of anthropology, which likes to look at things that must stay the same. I'm really only interested in things that are about to fall apart or definitely are going to change. The kinds of things that we've looked at in the past have been around notions of ownership in the West. And now I'm working on sort of three different kinds of things. And shifts of responsibility, as many of you know, here and abroad, your things like retirement are no longer stable. You actually have to plan for yourself. Your health care, you often go in with stacks of stuff to your doctor. Financial planning is now your burden, not the bank. So we looked at that shifts in responsibility before and ownership before. Right now, I'm actually looking at two things. One is the emergence of contingent work, or gig workers are a part of that. The sharing economy is part of that. But that's definitely causing some shifts. And the other one has to do more with technology itself, with the rise of smart assistants. And I'll talk a little bit about that. But I want to go through some of the things I've done before as sort of examples. Do you like questions as I go along, or do you want questions at the end?
Would you like people to interrupt you with questions if they come up? Or we can, if anything comes up, otherwise we'll have time for questions at the end.
Okay, I'll do questions at the end. And which one is supposed to be done? I forgot to ask.
Oh.
We were 6 o'clock?
I think that's where we sort of planned for the 2.5 hour reading. I would say between 4:15 and 4:30.
Okay, I'll try to make some further. So one of the questions is, how do you get your work? This is totally a reasonable question. So a colleague and I were I forget what we were actually working on, but we were sitting, Dawn Aphis is her name, we were sitting around in the bar after work on Friday and having a beer, and she goes, "God, I'm so busy this weekend." And I go, "My God, you're like the 100th person to tell me that this week. What's going on?" And it turned out that as we just sat around and started listening to our colleagues a lot, this was about 2007, just before a crash. A lot of people were really busy. And whenever people started using language like that, we get a little interested in what that might mean. And we were doing some studies on some other things. We happened to be in London. People in London were busy. The people in Shanghai were busy. People in Sao Paulo were busy. And so it wasn't just American busy. People everywhere were busy people. And they were more than willing to tell you about being busy. And people's kids were busy. If their kids were busy, they were worried. It was an amazing phenomenon of busyness that was happening. And so we said, well, let's look at this. And so we did this in our usual way of figuring out, well, we need to do a lot of studies. I personally, whenever I have a chance, go to Brazil. But we did bike messengers in the UK. In London, actually, looking at, well, how do people think about time in terms of like minutes or hours? We did some work with freelancers in San Francisco. How do people think about time when you're thinking about quarter-long segments? We did work with beachgoers. You can tell these are old. Those are good. We did beachgoers in Brazil, because we thought there was a pace there around days and weeks that might be kind of interesting. We did work with transnational import-export people on the micro scale in northern China. People who went from China over to Russia for half a year with goods and then come back and refresh. Looking at how are people thinking about time and scales of time to try to get to figuring out what's this busyness going on. Well, and so as you can see, part of that is to say we don't do anything in a quarter. That took us a year and a half to do all that work. So our projects tended to be a little longer than what you might imagine. And we stayed focused on the same thing through the whole time. It was time in this case, and particularly trying to figure out busyness. But each of these had also a little other kinds of projects that we might investigate while we were along the way. I did a lot of work as it came up in the conversations around security in Rio. And so I learned a little bit about security, as any of you might do as you do field work. You learn more than what you focus on. But we definitely had sort of like an arc. We said, doing business for the next year and a half, here's how we're, well, 3 years, doing business for the next 3 years, and here's how we're approaching it. But we, of course, had to make a business justification why we thought that was the case, which changed over time. But we are mad, it's a skill that you develop. One of the things that we did was as anthropologists, we have trouble keeping track of people when we're not there. When I went to the Azores to do my field work, I was basically hanging around with people for 2 years for like anything better to do because it's there. Unfortunately, I have a job which doesn't enable that to happen anymore. And so we go, like we were in Brazil, that beach is probably 3-4 weeks. That's about the max we ever go anywhere in the field these days. But it's interesting to know, well, what happens when you're not there? Because, you know, stuff does happen. So what we did was we got people to instrument their laptops with this data tracking system that tracked what you do every second. So in terms of what power you were using, how much power you use, so real engineering things at all. So as well as what kinds of applications, how hot it was running. It did, I mean, anything that's in your laptop, where it was located, I mean, anything you can imagine was being tracked. So we had what has become known as a large data, big data set. And we'd had a Berkeley graduate student in, well, Berkeley grad, PhD grad in, and he was a data scientist, and he was going to help us analyze the data. Well, he tried every pattern he could imagine through every math formula and couldn't make sense of the data. So we hauled him back to the field with us and talked to people. This is my friend. We talked to people about, we came up with a visualization they could look at it. We talked to people about their own data and said, hey, tell me about what was happening this particular day or this particular time. And then we opened up the charts, we made them nice and big so people could see them. And they would go, oh, I was, I was on my way to my mother's and was wanting to watch the football game and blah, 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 blah. And so you end up with all these stories about life from the data. But for us, the thing that we had to go back to time, these were broken up by days, didn't matter to you, but, was that people were talking about being interrupted a lot. Life seemed to be more like a constant set of interruptions rather than a stable state. So you would sit down and watch TV, the phone would ring. You'd be taking your kids to the park, and then you'd actually have to go and feed the dog because it got sick. Things always seem to be happening in people's life, and the norm seemed to be interruption rather than stability. And this was in, you know, for us, was the only way we could then make sense of the data. But without the insight, we really had nothing. And so we ended up with things like this. So I'm going to explain this to you, and we're going to do a quick forward and backwards. Don't be afraid, there's no numbers here. Each of these lines represent one of the 200 people that were in this particular study. And the over the course of 8 weeks, the yellow represents how often their computer was active, meaning somebody was physically on it. And the dark, of course, it represents. So a lot of time here during the course of 8 weeks. This person, not so much time there during the course of 8 weeks. Pretty simple to read, right? And each line is a person. And so there's a pattern here. There's actually a couple different patterns here. One of the patterns is really well known to people in the tech business and has been true since the beginning of time, at least as long as I've tracked people, is that usage happens mostly in the afternoon and at night. So rocket science, no big deal. Really, we found nothing. For us, however, the great thing was oh, people are constantly being on and off of their machines. It's not as if they log on at this, you know, at 8 and are sitting there until 10. They're actually being interrupted constantly during these phases. So what does that mean for a company like ours? Well, we combined it with this chart, which you can't quite see as well here. This time we made people horizontal, vertical, just to freak people out. It's always good to keep management a little concerned about what's actually going on, so they need to keep you employed to explain charts to them. And in this case, it's like, the key is off this one, sorry. The dark blue is a 5-minute interval, 10, 5, 10, 30, an hour, and then it doesn't really take a rocket scientist. In fact, any middle manager can look at this chart and go, wow, people are basically on their machines 5 minutes without being interrupted. So you go, oh, so what? Well, I'll tell you what. Our engineering teams design around people being on their machines 2 hours at maximum capacity. How many of those do you see on this chart? Oh, I know, one. We were designing around an activity that people were not doing. We were designing around an invisible user that had nothing to do with the reality that the public experiences. So we worked with the engineering team and developed what became known as Intel Turbo, which is exactly designed around this problem, just like turbo in your car. You know, start up and down, kicks in. So you're not designing around maximum capacity anymore. Now you're designing around quick starts. So this is kind of a story of a little bit about you know, what we were seeing and how we applied it. Now there are some other interesting things that happened along the way that weren't particularly of interest to the company. We got interested in, so people were busy, they're being, and we now have evidence that they were being interrupted through stories and through the data. It turns out that if you do time logs in any country, Russia, Japan, US, Canada, Brazil, doesn't have very good records, but people have more free time when we were doing the study than they did before, and yet they were busy. And so we did a little more analysis and we realized that busyness became a marker for the middle class more than anything else. So unless you were busy, you would literally get, what are your kids doing this summer? I don't know, I don't have any plans yet. The response was, oh, well, we need to get right on that. What are you gonna work out, right? We were interested in the notion of busyness as something you had to have to be a participant in the middle class rather than just a state of being. It was an actual social marker. So for us, this was kind of interesting side. And this was two anthropologists at San Jose State, Chuck Dara and J.M., I forget the last name, of course, happened to be working at the same time as us, although they couldn't share their data because they were writing an academic journal. And so their conclusion was, they wrote a book about how busy families in Silicon Valley are being stressed out and have a whole detail about all the stresses of individual life, the fracturing of the family, and the world is going to go to fall apart. And all those that may have come true, as it turns out, it didn't, because they were missing they were caught up in the language without really looking at what the meaning was behind it. And I think those kinds of shifts are what, so going back to busyness, those are the kinds of shifts that we try to find as we do our work. Make sense, I hope. I love Chuck, no, he has to. The other kind of thing I mentioned before, when we were doing the time study, one of our groups was freelancers. We were interested. They were, you know, frankly, there were a handful in San Francisco in 2005, 2006. There was hardly anything at that time. And then we were in the process of doing this other study, and we started to look at spaces. We work in New York, which is a cooperative workspace. There were two spaces in New York, and I think two or three in San Francisco, one in Shanghai, one in Mumbai. And we were just kind of exploring what is the nature of work as well. You know, that's kind of interesting to us. And nothing came out of this, just like nothing came out of freelancers earlier. But I was, when I came back from the study, I was asked to develop a mobile strategy for Intel. So develop a mobile, what should our mobile usage models and platforms look like so that they get used by people? And I'm sitting there thinking, well, let's see, I just studied all these freelance workers in these spaces. So obviously the answer is the mobile strategy shouldn't be about mobile at all, it should be about data. Because all they were really interested in was the data on their machines, the data in the environment, the data, data, data. And they weren't really interested in mobility. All those problems were solved. They had solved, you know, the battery wasn't fantastic, but it was okay. And if it wasn't okay, they had power plugs by their couch, they had power plugs on the plane, you know, wireless was mostly available everywhere you wanted to go, coffee shops. All the problems around mobility were solved, but the problems they had, how do I get my data from my machine at home to my machine here? How do I get, and then I extrapolated that up and said, well, you know, more and more things are becoming smart. So, you know, Intel, we really need to get a data strategy going. And started work around considering how Intel should play in the data economy, because I'm supposed to do businesses. That's my job. That has taken took a couple of different directions. One, Don, who you saw earlier, has been studying the quantified self movement for now 5 years. So again, just to give you a kind of scale on the work that we do, it's not always long, it's not always short either. In this particular case, what's sort of interesting here for us was, I forget this woman's name. Anyway, we'll call her Jeanette, because I just can't, sorry, can't think of it. But she has an autoimmune disease. And this, she's at a, this is a public appearance. I don't usually do people's faces unless it's public. This is at a public meetup event for Quantified Self. And she was explaining that ideally her goal, according to her fitness tracker, was that she should do 10,000 steps a day. The problem was, just by doing a little self-monitoring, she discovered that if she did 10,000 steps a day, it actually made her sick. So there was the, there's a couple things there. One that we've found over and over again is that people are actually really good judges of how to interpret their own data as opposed to having it interpreted for them. The other one was normative is often not normative because the variation in all of us is so great. And the other, the final thing for the wearables group was that they had been designing around all these people who were fitness experts and just said, oh, don't pay attention to the long tail of the people with illnesses. And when we did some quantifiable work around a set of these, it turned out that all the fitness people, not all, the vast majority of fitness people had actually had some kind of illness or traumatic health event earlier in their recent past, which had prompted them to either do more exercise or do slightly less if it was a change. So we were shifting both what counted as numbers, because we were interested in data, so how do people make sense of data, because we thought that was going to be very important going forward, as well as what kinds of things should Intel be thinking about in terms of if we're going to launch a product, what would it look like. So this whole set of stuff, you know, got turned into an app called DataSense, which I don't know if you can download anymore or not, but we use that as a way to try to understand how do people read and interpret their own data? How can we enable better data literacy if we're going to make the ecosystem go? And then the other thing that has resulted in on the engineering side, which is really what matters to a hardware company, is we're developing a context platform around trying to gather as much sensory data as we can so that we can make help people make better judgments. And the DataSense app itself can take in almost any data set that you could possibly imagine, temperature, skin tension, or wetness, anything you can think of that there's a sensor for, it can read and help you interpret that data. So the long ethnographic side ends up turning into sort of softer hardware implementation. And we're not, it's unclear whether, that's not a new business for us, but the platform is a new kind of offering a context platform is going to be a new kind of offering for them that we haven't done. All right, so if we do kind of these normal 4-week ethnographies and we do 5-year long quantified self ethnographies, what other kind of work do we do? You probably, no one in this room will remember National Day of Civic Hacking. Are the first two of those, I sponsored those with the Obama administration. And we were, besides being interested in your personal data, I'm really interested in how data flows and how we can use data to create communities and social good. And flat out, this is known throughout Intel. It's not a problem. So I sponsored the National Day of Civic Hacking. Here, we were trying to do something very explicit. The event took place over 2 days, on a weekend, the weekend in June, second in May. The first one happened in 89 cities, 6 countries, and about 1,500 participants. And so if you don't know what a hacking event is, we come in with a challenge, and then you're supposed to try to develop solutions during the course of 2 days. Some of those come off to be businesses, some of those not. Our challenge here was to say, well, we have these national data sets that are open. Can you develop applications that would get Paul and Andy to share their data and also access what Obama has opened up? So it's no longer just Jeanette by herself with her own data talking to people about it, but now we have to get people to actually share data. And is that possible? And what would that look like? Because I'm interested in, you know, the social nature of data, not just the personal nature. Ethnographically, we don't have 89 people to send around to all these cities, believe it or not. So what we did was we have a team of 8, and we went to 8 of us went to 8 different sites and sort of captured the values that were trying to be communicated in the different kinds of applications that were developed. Did this reflect a concern for seniors? Does this reflect concern for the environment? How do people imagine what security and what kinds of data do people who are these developers imagine users are willing to share? So we were trying to look at a space before it exists. There were literally no apps or applications that did that at the time. It was sort of a success in that we selected 6 companies that we then incubated a little further. But I want to tell you what we learned. We kind of had hypotheses around this going in, but we also learned more about this, is that the social has really shifted at that time. It was mostly about no obligations. So I grew up in Illinois. I went to the same church my entire life. I went to the same public library my entire life. Well, I left. And we had a sense of you know, endurance. I would show up on Saturdays at the library and I did library time as a library monitor to help the community. What we were thinking about when we set up these hacking experiments was the nature of social has shifted from these long, permanent, deep relationship based. Like I was Mary Kay was the head librarian when I was there, and like she, even after I left Moline, she still wrote me. It was a relationship based thing with a long time. But there was a new kind of social participation happening, which was really much more around light engagement. Something easy to get into, easy to get out of, some kind of reward. We had pizza and beer at most of these, which seems to be enough to keep people going. That there's an actual good outcome. So most of these people felt there was something good that could happen within this 48 hours. They didn't have to sit there the whole 48 hours. They could come and go as they pleased, and they still could have contributed to the Portland data hacking. At the same time, you could also extend your network, find new friends in a way that's sort of hard to do in cities today. So we were interested not only in the application for the data and implications for Intel, but we're also at the same time constantly trying to understand the environment in which people live and operate. So like busyness, our whole design now around thinking about the social has significantly shifted at Intel to thinking about what can we do for light engagements, meet a lot of people. People can leave anytime, but they get a lot out of it, which is an interesting design sort of challenge. I also tried another experiment where I tried to create a revolution online. you can still find traces of this. It's a problem with the web. It doesn't really go away. But so if I did these community things, you know, physical communities, could I actually generate enough online interest to change awareness, at least around personal data? Back before Apple had a fight with the FBI, which seems to have been a landmark decision, which seems to have a greater impact than even Snowden had, there was me and we the data. And so we said, well, can we excite enough interest around this for people to actually care about their personal data? Because frankly, people don't care. And the first step is education and caring. So if you want to get amused sometime, you can check out We the Data. The World Economic Forum actually let me come in and sort of pretend like they were going to be interested in the people and the people's interests. But this one, unlike the experiments around the natural data civic hacking, didn't turn out so well, and the website kind of died. But we try experiments, that's what I'm saying. And it's not just physical world. You know, a lot of times people think anthropology is either like virtual communities or physical communities. We tend to look at that as a permeable bound and try to figure out just stuff about people in general. And I actually got nowhere for the company, except for they did get a little PR, and that was fine. So as I said, I'm interested in sharing data and community data. I still am convinced Intel should do something. I'll tell you the answer now. They don't do anything in the end, but I won't spoil the story. This is another sort of experiment we did. This is these little blue things are air quality monitors that we deployed in Northwest Portland. Northwest Portland is one of the more exclusive areas of town. But it's also amongst people known for its air pollution. Not widely known at the time we did this, but you know, it's really easy to see on any, if you're part of the Oregon air quality people, you know this is really a bad area. So we put in air trackers, and we were prompted actually by, it shows a runner. This is part of the performance art for Intel. Runners are a huge market. But it was really prompted by a mom who had a kid with really severe asthma that was triggered often, and she was trying to figure out, what is the optimal path from our house to school? So, you know, this is really deep learning on our part, but it turns out that we thought, well, you know, there's something there. And so we stuck in these, we got people to agree, nobody forced anybody. But we stuck these air people volunteered to have these they're called eggs, air quality monitors around the neighborhood, and then Richard designed a little app to help the kid get to school. It never was used by runners. It's but the data is actually real, and there's a couple of things to note. So everybody was happy to help the kid, like universal happiness about this, because it's not that big of a neighborhood and people kind of knew him. But there's and we were interested, again, the point was data sharing. All these things are located at people's houses, so you have to allow people to look at the data. It's not quite as personal, perhaps, as you know, your biometric data might be, but nonetheless, it's your data. And one of the things that happened almost right away was that people started collecting data in the neighborhood and said, Portland City Council, we have a lot of pollution. Fix that. Pretty literally, they arrived at the city council meeting, threw up these charts, and said, we have a lot of pollution, fix it. And so there was this activism that grew from the data, which we really used. It was like, okay, people are actually kind of using this in ways that we hadn't really thought of. We were only thinking about the running app. They came up with this other side. We didn't invent that for them, they did that on their own, which was really cool. Well, that's great, you know, and now the city council is learning about air pollution. And then, you know, anything the city council gets published in the newspaper. So now it became an issue that this community had high air pollution. I might have mentioned it was expensive, one of the most expensive apartments. So then that goes to, people sell their homes, don't they? And you'll notice on this chart that although it might be high, red dots are kind of air pollution, might be high pollution overall, there are some places that are higher than others. And so we had a decrease in housing prices, and then not everybody's house decreased in the same amount because these are actual patterns, and then this egg disappears. So it was the whole kind, which then of course, you know, also stands out if you happen to, this was a public chart for a long time, public data coming in every second. It turns out that if you happen to be house hunting, one of the things you might do is kind of look and see where the pollution was, and if you're going to live in this neighborhood, you know, which house, you know, would you rather be over in this part of the woods? And it affected housing prices, and they saw a 20% drop in housing prices.
Which is a lot.
Of course, there's other factors going on. There's a lot of building going on in inner Portland, and gentrification happening, so there are other, it became a different market, but nonetheless, the little eggs started to disappear pretty quickly, and then they were gone. So we were interested in people are willing to share, and they were willing to share publicly to get something done. But then, as the data circulated, maybe it wasn't such a good thing. Now, Intel is still doing stuff around, you know, Paul's work. So what's the business thing? So it turns out that this gave us an idea about this, and we did some precision agriculture, but we did a number of little projects around shared data. A lot of projects around shared data. But one of the things that we've been talking to Intel about is changing, again, I'm trying to do new businesses, to start thinking about the Internet of Things, people, Internet of Things. So instead of thinking about just selling these little $100 items, which would be $10 in a week, items as a kind of market, that we've presented a case to the management that we should think about how insurance might be the key economic factor in Internet of Things, like advertising was in the web. And that has caused a little shift to be going on, and at least it's still in discussion, not settled. But it's kind of because it turns out, you know, insurance companies are really interested in this stuff and are more than willing to fund this kind of activity, primarily in your home, for home insurance people. And so I don't know if you know this, but like the Nest has a fire alarm now, that if you get the fire alarm, you get a discount from State Farm or Allstate, I get them mixed up, because they can monitor your activity. So that came up after we did the prop to the class, out to the people, but it's a kind of way that we kind of take things and we look at them, we try to learn from them, but then the business implications are not always exact findings as we think about them and require a little bit of extrapolation. I'm gonna show you something, I forgot, what's your name?
Phil.
That only Phil will probably recognize. So I wanna talk about, again, you know, I don't write a lot of reports. I mean, to be honest with you, I write so few reports. It's part of the reason why I left academia is I don't like writing. This is a business opportunity canvas. It's used, a version of this is used almost at every business school on the planet. Anybody who does any kind of lean or agile development, any startup in the Bay Area who wants money, they will have developed a business opportunity canvas. We worked with the Haas School of Business at Berkeley, and we created our own. And what is of interest to the anthropologist here is that in the process of creating your own, if you let anthropologists talk to business people, they will, of course, bring in anthropology under some rubric. A lot of the kind of factors that go into this are really based on kind of, you know, anthropological points of view. Not entirely. I'm not going to say anthropology is going to save your life in the business world. But it's perceived as a competitive advantage if we start plugging our businesses into this kind of model. On the dating, you know, so you kind of get the idea? The real, you know, important stuff, this is the part that we kind of contribute more to, and then a little bit down here into what are the experiments that we do. But in our world, this all that data stuff that we were doing, you might remember the running, the air quality monitors, the quantified self, a number of other projects we did, turned into looking like this, and you don't really have to get it, but the kind of compelling part is that it provided a space for us to explore, and then we proceeded on sort of doing this. This is the 16th part of the hacking experiment as well, of discovering value. So did we end up launching our product in the data space? No, we did not do that. We were total failures on this, except we did convince Intel to make two acquisitions, which was a pretty big deal around data analytics. And now they're considering, they have them, they're not committed, but they're considering again what to do with this as a capability because they have to come up with a new business model for the company. So it's partly to illustrate that we have to play well with others. It's not always engineers, it's often business people. Not always designers, it's sometimes other people. And then we have to kind of learn how to speak their language, and ideally, this to me is a great win because we convinced the business school at Haas that we have a better approach to new business models than just business students do, business faculty do. I have like two more things. So I talked a lot about stuff we've done in the past. I currently am working on three different things. And I do these in corporate speak on purpose instead of spelling them out because you have to learn to read an acronym is really fast in this world. In fact, Intel has a dictionary of an acronyms, an online, a Wikipedia version. So the top one is artificial intelligence, cognitive computing, machine learning. It has different people depending on if you're engineering or computer science, has different names, or business has different names. But here, a lot of our work is trying to figure out something smart about the analytics space. So I work a lot with, there's a lot of engineers around Intel. I don't know if this is going to work for you, but as a sort of fun experiment, whenever you hear people talking about algorithms, substitute the word God and see what happens. And in my world, it doesn't change the meaning at all. So I'll be interested to see if that happens with people, which then instantly gets me interested in this area of algorithms. Now, I don't do math. I don't understand computing. Flat out can't program in any language. But whenever something that sounds like it's important can be replaced by God, you got to kind of wonder what these things are about. And the great thing about algorithms is if you drift over there to the computer science building, you'll hear people talk about them as pretty neutral in value. They're like the beautiful, pristine flower of the field. No one has touched them. They just execute flawlessly. The world is a great place. But it doesn't take long to start thinking about, well, you know, what is the actual effect of some of these? And so when Google started out, the algorithm, which is, you know, they have one of the better ones, I would say. If you typed in, she invented in the search line, it replied, did you mean he invented? Because it had gone through all the compiled records that they have, and the proper response, or the most common response, or appearance is he. He invented the light. He invented the table. He invented is a common one. So part of the thing is like, what's being counted, what's being pulled into these algorithms that make them give the results that they give? And if we leave it just at the data set that's out there, the corpus behind us, it doesn't really help us move forward. So they're kind of interesting things for that. Another one is that, you know, I'm going to pick on Google a little bit. I might have to apply for a job there, so don't. No, it's okay. Another one is they pride themselves on having really developed, giving you the results as they are, au naturel. This is just what it is, all right? And yet most of you probably know that they blocked the image of Michelle Obama that was doctored up to make it look like a baboon, and then they ran into problems with monkeys being identified falsely as African Americans. So they do tweak things, but you know, those we consider good, but we don't know what they might not be tweaking that's not good. So for example, Amazon had 157,000 gay literature books that disappeared from their shelf because they got listed as adult. And Amazon doesn't do adult books. Now, you would never know that. How would you ever know this unless you actually started looking at what are the patterns that these people are searching on and not searching on? In Android, which is Google again, but different Google. In Android, if you downloaded Grindr, which is a sort of a gay matchmaking app, but also ask, are you interested in sexual predator app? Now, here, you go back to the question of he and she. Is there a correlation there, or is this a bad algorithm? Now, they claim, oh, it's just a bad algorithm, and then they fix it within, you know, 2 months, but it still took them a while to fix it. Because they don't really know how these things work on a certain level, which is also an interesting problem. So I find algorithms to be sort of the new space for anthropologists. I was talking to, okay, how many people know Thai? Handful, okay. So Thai, what came out last, I think it was last, I'm a little bit lost in travel. I think last week is a Microsoft smart interactive product. Imagine Siri, only Microsoft. All right, that's hard to imagine. But the Thai is a really smart program that was supposed to use natural language to start communicating with people. And it was within the week that it was launched, it had turned out to be spewing racist language, hurling swear words. It was pretty much a bad boy of bad girl, as it was, of the IA rules. So Microsoft took it offline and stuff. Now, this has been interesting for the tech world because they were going, oh, these girls, it was a bunch of girls, or that's what's fine. Got online and they rigged the thing to do this bad behavior on purpose as kind of a prank or a joke. And so, you know, we'll recover, we'll figure out algorithms to figure that out. Like when Waze is a mapping thing, for a while people were in a particular part of LA were texting that the traffic was really bad at their home because they didn't want cars driving through there, it became a shortcut. And the new, because Waze would find shortcuts that people didn't know, so they were texting they were Wazing that it was super traffic jam. So, you know, Google figured out and said, this is fake because these people are not moving. And so the whole thing is, well, you know, Microsoft is going to figure out when people are trying to prod on artificial intelligence and whether or not. For me, it was interesting because it highlights a problem that we were just talking about, is that all languages, or all knowledge, is tribal. There is no neutral language. There's no neutral knowledge. Somebody is behind it. It's on somebody's side. In this particular case, you know, it turned out to be a bunch of supposedly girls. I don't believe that, but not racist men, but it turned out to be a bunch of teenage girls. And it matched them perfectly. It actually performed outstandingly well. It said, here's the knowledge they want me to learn. This is the way they're interacting. This is how I should do it. It matched them fantastically. Is that what we want? And are those the people that we want? And so for us as anthropologists, or for you as anthropologists, I think AI is a sort of an interesting space for us to explore, because it raises questions about what tribe do you belong to, whose knowledge is this, classic things from when I was a graduate student, who has the power, and what's being hidden and what's being revealed. So like insurance companies, because we've been dealing with insurance companies, so insurance companies can now figure out gender and income without using gender, income, and ethnicity measures through Facebook and LinkedIn. And they're allowed to discriminate based on that for bank loans and health insurance rates, because it's not personal information. So the whole area about big data and about, particularly about AI, I think is fascinating. I told this to Andy, I'm having a current issue with two anthropologist friends of mine. when I was an anthropologist, so what is AI? Is it extra species? Is it just technology? And when I was in graduate school, I remember learning about the distinctions between humans were the only tool makers. We thought that for a while. We don't think that anymore. Humans were the only ones with language. We thought that for a while. We don't think that anymore. Humans are the only ones that do social organization. We thought that for a while. We don't think that anymore. We're having the same issues now with artificial intelligence. Is it language? Tiling the language perfectly? Is it, the robots. So robots are the physical instantiation. So for me, robots are the same thing. Can robots make tools? Yep. Can they make tools that they aren't programmed to make? Yep. So is it tool making? Mm-hmm. The current one that I'm stuck on is humor. I think AI can do humor. I have a friend who doesn't agree. But the very core of anthropology is really going to be revealed in how we start to interact with and think about artificial intelligence. This is not to mention the real dangers around jobs, which I think are huge, and around the way that we do assessment of risk. But for me, this is a really interesting area. Anyway, and then the other ones I'm doing are AR, VR. I think there's huge changes are possible there for the social and contingent workers, which I've been trying to do for over 12 years. They finally let me do, and now I have all the data, so I don't even need to do field work anymore. We're looking at, it's very important for Intel to make sure there's a healthy middle class. Turns out wherever we have middle class, computers sell better. So they're concerned about the drop in wages and salaries. And what can we do about that? And I'm actually trying to create a platform that will supposedly help contingent workers. Anyway, so this is the end. I leave it to you to think about whether or not what we've been doing is just merely reporting on the world or actually trying to reformat the world in ways. And not in the futuristic, like I'm going to create the future way. I think that's kind of a scam. But in the way that giving people new opportunities to be themselves, to do things they haven't done. I think a smartphone that is smart and will actually help you or do things for you or argue with you is going to create a different kind of world than one that just answers to you. And ideas about smart toilets, which are actually kind of popular right now at Intel. Sure, some people are going to look at those as, I am now a programmer at the bathroom. Other people are just going to go, that's the place I piss. Right? It gives us YouTube. I'm working with a bunch of Gen Z kids. YouTube is about not only looking at content and learning how to do things you could never do before if you lived in Moline, Illinois, but it's also all about a way to present themselves and their knowledge to a wider audience than they had. Smartphones have enabled people in Tokyo particularly, and South Korea, to become reporters, and they were just citizens before. So I think that part of what our group tries to do is, I'm not going to invent those things for people to do, but I think we kind of drift towards the side of being engines of a new social model of just cameras, which is how I would register. So I thank you, and you can certainly ask questions, drop me an email.
Thank you very much. We do have time for questions. So,
I did go over what you told me, so I apologize.
Okay. Thank you very much. Great stuff.
You want me to answer somebody else?
Let's start with. Are there algorithms to measure processes that you would like to see designed because of the ethical push that might generate that are not saleable? In other words, the possibility for ethical movement forward to be the engine that seems to emerge so many moments here. What is it you'd like to be able to do that Intel hasn't yet provided an opportunity to do?
Well, the AI space is new. I've only been working on it for about a year. Or not even a year, last summer I started that. So I don't really know where I want to go with that one yet. I mean, in the end, I will recommend to Intel that we develop a platform that's really based around natural language processing and has cross data inputs. You know, like I already know the answer at a certain level, but how I get there and why I'm not sure. I found it to be extremely hard. Part of what gets lost if you go for a norm of any kind is the variance. We were talking earlier that it would be easy for me to imagine a really good algorithm that would be completely biased against LGBT. I mean, that is so easy for me to imagine. It's not even imagination. We could have Arab citizens, an algorithm that would find and track Arab citizens without much work. It's not that hard. I mean, it's really not hard. So algorithms are so big and they cover a lot of space. I'm not sure what I want to do. I just think they're super dangerous, and not just for the reasons of job replacement. I mean, you know, on a simple level, all I do is spot patterns, really. And I can imagine if you had the right parameters, you could get a program that would help me with that immensely. And eventually replace me because the cost differs. So, you know, the difference between what I deliver and it delivers will probably be minimal, and it would cost a one-time implementation versus, you know, years. So I'm actually not concerned about that. I think we will figure out different kinds of relationships with technologies. We always have done, and there will be new jobs, and that will be changed. But I am concerned because the algorithms themselves are invisible to people. You cannot, even if you saw it, you couldn't make sense of it. And so I find that it poses for me some more harder questions than I've had to deal with before in terms of trying to figure out how I actually feel about it and what I think is a good course of action. Does that make sense?
Yes.
It's a bad answer, but
I'm interested in the potential for interventionist action. For instance, could that algorithm track xenophobes as opposed to?
Yeah, sure. We can.
And then the language come up, say, did you mean she invented?
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, to sort of flip those around. Is there any traction there?
Yeah, there's no traction for that. There's traction for trying. I didn't mention this. So one of the huge shifts that Google has brought to the world is that they don't ever talk about is, and Facebook has followed this, I'm sure, the shift from accuracy to satisfaction. So your Google results are based on 200 different variables that they think are going to satisfy you that are run like that. They're not based on what is the best possible answer, but they're based on how am I going to satisfy you. And I think that shift is pretty fundamental in terms of the amount of, Facebook, of course, has been called out on this. Your Facebook feed is based in large part on what do they think is going to make you most happy to keep you coming back in order for them to sell more ad space. Google is the same thing. They're based on you coming back. They're not based on, and then the little ads pop up. They're not based on delivering you accurate information, they're based on making you satisfied. And so I think it makes it a little harder for us to navigate a world if we're being satisfied all the time and knowing what's not. I mean, I don't know, just an opinion. But I think that shift is huge. And you know, what does it say about the kind of knowledge that we collectively as researchers produce? And how it interfaces with the kind of knowledge that the computer science world is. I'm sorry.
You were, I guess, starting to address this toward the end, but I wondered if you might want to talk a little more about thinking back to your graduate career in an anthropology department. Could you talk about the kinds of courses and books and inquiries that were most helpful to your life now and least helpful, thinking about folks in the room or thinking about the graduate curriculum, you know, looking into the 21st century?
Yeah, it was not apparent in this talk that I'm an anthropologist, right? I mean, it was kind of well buried. I apologize for that. I realized that when I got to the end. it's, you know, the, I think that varies by the different kinds of anthropology jobs that are available to, or jobs that different anthropologists. My graduate career was, a long time ago, but also a really classical. I was telling Andy, for my for our methods class, we read ethnographies. I mean, I didn't interview anybody. I didn't learn how to write surveys. I didn't do video or tape recording. I read ethnographies for my methods class. So it was, you know, highly structured. And I was still taping. I don't know if I would disclose this. No, I'm just kidding. I was definitely a postmodernist when I was in graduate school. My dissertation was largely based on Derrida, and I had a colleague who, of course, quote Derrida in French. I never got that far. I don't think that any one course really changed my life. But I think that the approach that anthropology teaches you about approaching people as real people, as individuals, to understand something greater is huge. And how I've done most of my work, the system approach, or holistic, sorry, flipped into business speak there for a minute. The holistic approach that anthropology teaches is of immense value if you want to be an anthropologist. And that's kind of where my value comes from, somebody who's not an anthropologist, because I will consider a wider range of things, and literally it's not uncommon for colleagues in engineering or business side to go, that's Ken Lincoln. Which is shorthanded for, I pulled in something about households into some conversation about security. I mean, it's like, that's not security. That's, and we collectively do that. We create puzzles. You know, we put together puzzles from the experiences that we have in the field in order to create a part of that. And in the work with my group, there's about 8 of us. I'm sorry, I didn't say this. There's 4 teams now, about 4 teams in Intel, all of about 6 people, 16 people. Who are doing this? We used to all be building out the explosive party. In my group itself, when we're trying to figure out problems, we will talk about things like the network of data stuff that was up there a while ago about communities of data. Goes back to economic anthropologist at Minnesota, and what we borrowed straight out from his thing is a way, we just took his model, which is all about brides, and ours is about data, and swapped out the word bride or data, and it works fine, because it's not all about economics, it's actually about a lot of other things, and good relationships, and so we were able to, called myself a culture slut before. It's like I just take cultures, theories slut. I take theories and apply them wherever they work, so that it helps me explain stuff in ways that are helpful. But it wasn't a particular theory class. It wasn't a particular theorist. I actually never used Derrida. But one of the things that my anthropology department taught me, my experience. I had worked my way through graduate school on grants with tech companies. So imagine 5 years of doing grants with tech companies. And they didn't count that as field research. They wouldn't let me do my dissertation on that. And that definitely affected how I approach life and how I approach the field. I don't hold it against them by any stretch, because it's just the way it was. It was just the way it was. And I appreciate having live somewhere else. But it did help me think about, well, what constitutes that my interpretation of our anthropology could go is somewhat different than the field. And so I'm kind of had to live with that tension for many years.
Thank you.
Is that good enough? Okay. But you did see that job I had posted earlier, so that anybody can be a research strategist who's a graduate student today, just get your damn degree, get your degree done, and then move on. Sorry, go, Paul.
Yeah, Ken, let's say you, top management, Intel, they're doing some advanced planning on the next gen of processors the company's
yeah.
going to come out with. How often do they routinely come to the anthropologists for their inputs, or are you constantly struggling to say, hey, we're over here, we have some inputs on that processor?
Well, at this point, after
can you talk about that problem?
Yeah, after been there, you know, I've been there for 15 years, so it's definitely changed over time. And the question now isn't come over and talk to us. We are invited to the table, as they say in the business world. But we still have to argue that what we think is better than what the marketing department thinks. Or what the, because they love trends. Trends are, you know, anytime you have a trend, it's a great thing. I don't do trends. And, or you know, why, even though there's 100 engineers looking at video compression, that really that's not where you should be looking, you should be looking somewhere else. So we have arguments, and sometimes we win, and sometimes we don't win, but we are there. They don't keep us away. We are now invited in. And when I first got there, they would often hold meetings and not invite me.
Right.
or anybody from my team. I mean, I was assigned it, and then, oh, forgot to let you know about the meeting. Sorry about that. Yeah, that was a month ago. Well, that's okay. We decided already. But now it's a, it is a, there is a, there is a recognition in the industry as a whole now, which is very different than 15 years ago, that understanding people and contexts really matter to the success of your product. It just is a fact of life. And we used to not, as an industry, a tech industry, used to not think that way in the 90s. And I think part of the lesson of the crash of the 90s, which many of you won't remember, was that we really need to be paying attention to what end users actually need or want.
Absolutely.
Instead of just making stuff. And the student sells.
Yeah, trying to see if you can maybe make this an announcement. I don't know. So, I mean, one of the things that's come up in a couple different ways has to do with sort of ethics, right, and issues, unintended consequences of both sort of emerging digital technologies and invisible algorithms and sort of newer digital things that are going on. So, from I think. You know, a number of us in this room, in terms of anthropology, do take sort of activist or interventionist types of approaches, right? And so I guess my question is, you know, can you model some kind of practice of, we know there's, sorry, I've got too many ideas.
Yep.
We know, for example, with the internet, that all sorts of stuff happened, right? And the unintended or intended consequences of that were realized down the road. And so we have this backtracking of policymakers making policies that don't work really well, right? So especially with developments in artificial intelligence and machine learning, not so much I don't think in augmented and virtual reality, but with AI, you know, is there a role for anthropologists to identify the disconnect between what's driving the creation of product and the way it's read by potential consumers, right? I mean, because, for example, with big data right now, one of the concerns is, of course, insurance companies can monitor and track and discriminate in various ways, right? That users of products may not realize, right? Or when they do realize, it becomes too late.
Yeah.
So is there an anthropological role there?
I will give you an answer that is what I'm doing. But I don't necessarily think that's the right answer for everyone. So there, what you've identified is, for me, a lag between policy and technology, which is only exacerbated these days. Our policy people are totally incapable of keeping up with technology changes that are going on, and often don't understand the implications of those until it's too late, until they get the story of, you know, Mary Jane being put out of her house for having posted on Facebook, you know, that her bank then follows that up, and then we'll look into that. I didn't mention this, but I work a lot with the Intel policy people and help them, try to guide them in directions that are better for consumers. Intel is in a unique position in that we don't actually sell it to people. It has this downside in that it's very hard to argue about customers, which a lot of anthropologists can do. They can argue about their customers. Intel, you know, my first week there, I met a senior vice president. He asked me, what was I doing there? I said, I'm here to help you understand your customer better. And he said, I was out golfing with Mike Dell last weekend, and I understand him just fine. And I walked away. I think that, but part of what we can do is, part of what Intel is interested in is ensuring an open environment that has no obvious negative consequences in technology development. And so their policy group works very actively in Washington, D.C., and I provide a lot of stuff for them. That's what I'm doing. I don't, you know, it's as close as I am. So when the FBI versus Apple case came up, I had email in my box instantly about what, from your position, not that we'll follow it, because that wasn't written there, but they, you know, it's implied, because they've avoided me many times, but from your position, what should we be talking about right now? And so that's kind of the place where I see it. I'm trying, I haven't found a way in yet with the AI for them, but that's what I'm working on. I did that with privacy with them, which is why they talked to me all the time for years into privacy. So I don't actually know. I don't know what it, but in my context, the place I can go is work through them right now. That was the last question.
No, it was announced as the last question, but it turns out
there's a difference between the words and action.
There's a trend of one extra question. I guess I was interested, if you'll indulge one more.
Yeah.
I was interested in the combination of knowing your customers better and also knowing yourself better in the sense of what an anthropologist in industry is doing. That sort of understanding the self or decentering a sense of self by knowing the other is baked into ethnography in that way. And I'm thinking about the very great example about the time use study, which told you something about how people were using their laptops and firing them up, but the payoff required a critical understanding of the assumptions you were making in the old ships that you were
right,
designing.
So you in that case is not necessarily me, but the company.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
Enough about you.
Yeah. Well, yes. So, anthropologists are always marginal. I mean, just get over it. And embrace it, realize that you're going to have one friend in life if you're lucky, and your partner will probably leave you. This is just anthropology. This is just it. But as part of that marginalization, you have to embrace the fact that wherever you work, you guys in the academy probably do this too, but wherever you work in business, your people are going to be where you're working. That should be your primary area of focus. I've never written a report on Intel, ever. Never, ever. But in order to do the translation of the work, I have to know them really well. And I have made severe mistakes in that area by not knowing them well enough. My first business opportunity I was trying to create back when I first started was a $4 to $10 million opportunity a year. I thought this was like super fantastic. Who would you know, for a startup, and then I had to chart the ramps like this, because I just paste those in actually, just figure out the numbers. And then I learned that Intel stock, and my friend Eric on this too, started the health division. Intel stock is based, the market assesses us primarily at that time by the average selling price, not revenues. So you think about stock reports, and revenues are this, and therefore it's good. But if we started a company where our margins were smaller than our chips, like the one I was proposing, then our stock would go down. So they wouldn't even touch it. It was like off the table. But I didn't understand, you know, going back, I'd been at the company a couple of years at that point. It's not like I was brand new, but I didn't understand how decisions were actually being made. And so I had to learn. And I've had to learn how to talking to middle management is different than talking to senior management. It's different than talking to engineers. It's different than talking to market research.
Yeah.
All in a company of our size, yeah, I think we're like main offices in five countries, over 100,000, 110,000 people. There's a lot of different kinds of knowledge you have to acquire, and it's best to know who you're talking to at all times and what they think is important. And I made this, contingent workers, you know, I was talking about them. Last year, I went in and talked to the head of the enterprise division and had this great model for how we could really, contingent workers for us, we have a consumer division and then we have an enterprise division. Contingent workers are, you know, freelancers are people who don't really fall into either of those camps. They have a lot more productivity, security, manageability requirements than like the consumers, but yet they don't have an IT department and buying the machines for them. So they're right in the middle. It's like huge opportunity. This is my pitch to them, it's a huge opportunity and you need to make these features and it would sell. And it was like, yeah, no. And then, I went back actually 4 weeks later as a staff, I talked to the staff and they said, you forgot the magic words, refresh and upsell. So all you have to do is just change this from, here's a refresh and upsell opportunity as opposed to just a sales opportunity. And he loved it. I'll be honest, it was like, I literally changed the two, but I put it on the first slide in the talk, and the whole conversation went a completely different direction. But you have to know what matters to people in order to translate the work in ways that are meaningful. And then, of course, I explained how, you know, this is going to be a huge upsell because these people are professionals, they're willing to pay more. I emphasized that for the next 20 minutes, I was more than obvious in the talk. But you do have to know what are the issues for people you're talking to, and they are very different. But yes,
so the ethnographic application is really...
It's really reversed.
60 degrees or something.
Got a noble sense. All right, thank you very much. Again, it was an honor to come here.